Namaskar. Today, I'm with Vinay Sharma. He's a fund manager with Nippon Asset Management Company. And just for the interest of our audience, I'm just speaking something in Malayalam. Ellavarkkum namaskaram. Innu nammal fund manager ayittu oru Nippon Mutual Fund ennu parayunna oru fund manager company ilthe oru fund manager undu, Vinay Sharma ennu parayunnathu. ഒത്തിരി എക്സ്പീരിയൻസ് ഉള്ള ഒരു ഫണ്ട് മാനേജറാണ് ഇദ്ദേഹം. ഐ സി ഐ സി ഐ അസറ്റ് മാനേജ്മെന്റ് കമ്പനിയിൽ ഉണ്ടായിരുന്നു. അത് കഴിഞ്ഞിട്ട് ആണ് നിപ്പോണ്ട് ഇപ്പോൾ സർവ് ചെയ്യുന്നത്. രണ്ട് ഫണ്ട് ഇദ്ദേഹം മാനേജ് ചെയ്യുന്നുണ്ട്. അപ്പോൾ ഇദ്ദേഹത്തിൻ്റെ ഒരു എക്സ്പീരിയൻസിൽ എങ്ങനെ പണം മാനേജ് ചെയ്യാം എന്നുള്ളതിനെ കുറിച്ചാണ് നമ്മൾ സംസാരിക്കുന്നത്. അപ്പോൾ ഇന്നത്തെ സംസാരം ഞാൻ ഇംഗ്ലീഷിലായിരിക്കും ഇനി കണ്ടിന്യൂ ചെയ്യാൻ പോണത്. സോ ഐ ഗെറ്റ് ബാക്ക് ടു ഇംഗ്ലീഷ്. സോ ഐ ജസ്റ്റ് സെറ്റ് ദ കോണ്ടെസ്റ്റ് ഇൻ മലയാളം ആൻഡ് വി ആർ ബാക്ക് ടു back to English and we can. So thank you so much, sir, for taking your time out to do the chat with us. And so as I said that this audience love to learn about money management and how to manage their money and what are the various options they have to secure their investment and ensure that whatever their goal they can meet and how to manage their retirement peacefully. So could you please take us through your experience? You have been to IIM, then you moved into a few international banks, then fund management you started. So if you can take us through that journey, from there we can take it up.
Sure. So basically, a lot of this in my life has happened not by design, and it's just that one thing happened after another, and things started getting things got interesting at some point of time. I got interested at some point of time, and that's how the journey continued. But I am from a very small town called Nathdwara in Rajasthan. It's a fairly famous religious destination. It's a temple, and the entire economy of that town revolves around religious tourism and the temple and the activities in around the temple. So that's where I grew up. I did my schooling, and from there I went to MNIT Jaipur, and I actually did my graduation in architecture. So I'm an architect.
I saw that.
Yeah. It's a very unique combination. I think they are, at least in industry, I don't know anyone else who's an architect and a fund manager. I'm sure there would be, but I am not aware of this combination. So it's sort of a unique combination for this industry. But yeah, so what was happening is that after finishing my graduation, I wanted to do some sort of technical post-graduation course in the field of structural engineering or civil engineering and design and all that. And there, when I was giving my competitive exams, one of my teachers just, she just said, why don't you apply for CAT also? Because the basic design of GMAT, GRE, CAT, all is fairly similar. These are all aptitude tests at the end of the day. So why don't you just give CAT as well? It will give you good practice. It will give you another dimension in your practice for GRE, GMAT. And I said, okay, not a bad idea. Of course, I should. And when I started giving my practice exams, there I started scoring fairly good in the sense like I was amongst the top 5-10 people in my state or something like that in the practice institute, not in the exam. And so I gave CAT and I got interviews from most of the IIMs and was selected at IIM Calcutta. And then there was no looking back because, I had no idea that I could ever get selected at IIM Calcutta. So once I got selected, then I thought, yeah, it's as good as maybe going abroad. And although the field is changing in the sense that some doing a post-graduation in some scientific in some science arena, now you have moved to management, but frankly I was not so aware about my career choices and options and all of that. So it just looked good and it was good enough and great enough, actually not good enough, it was just great from my point of view. So I went to IIM Calcutta, and from there it was just again a little bit of chance that my first job was Axis Bank. Earlier it was UTI at that point of time, and I was management trainee there. And just as I was finishing my 4 months of management training, I got an offer from JP Morgan in the research space, and some of my friends were already working in that office. And I thought, it's a nice city, nice name, nice office. I know people there. And then I moved to JP Morgan, and then there was no looking back, because that's where the investment journey started. That's where I came to know what is investment all about, what are different facets of investment, buy side, sell side, research, investing, all of that. So then I got hooked on to investing, and from there the actual investment journey started. Before that, it was just things happened in a certain manner, and that led me to this field.
So where do you kind of understood that you want to become a fund manager, and you are going to pursue this as a long term career as such? So how did that thought process came into you? And is it that you got good mentoring in the meantime, or is it like then that slowly you got into this industry? How did it really happen there?
Sure. So once you start working in this field, the field actually is very enticing and really dynamic, right? Because this is a field where so many things impact, what's going to be the result on a daily basis. There are global events, there are domestic events, there are company-specific events, there are sector-specific events. Just you have to be aware of so many things. And generally, by nature, I have been very inquisitive right from my childhood days. And I had a little bit of inclination towards all of these things, towards geopolitics, towards politics, towards economics, business fundamentals, all of that. Okay. And so it just kind of gelled very well along with my personality. And my second job, which was the first buy-side job that I had, AIG was actually establishing its asset management arm in India, and they were looking for analysts for that team. And the head of that venture at that point of time, Mr. Tushar Pradhan, he sort of hired me. Okay. And there I became, that was my first buy-side research and assignment. And then obviously there was no looking back from there, because once you become a research analyst, the ultimate ambition after a few years, you understand that the real charm of this job is managing money at the end of the day. At some point, you want to manage money like how your bosses are doing today. I'm talking of that point of time. That's how every analyst thinks. Okay. That I want to manage money at some point of time. And that comes fairly soon in that job profile, actually.
Okay.
So it was during the AIG days where my inclination towards managing money and the ultimate objective that I would be an analyst for 10, 12, 15 years, whatever it takes. And after that, I want to manage some money on my own. That started. And luckily for me, then several doors opened, and I was able to do that fairly soon in my life.
Okay.
So that's how it happened.
Okay, very, very interesting. And I, here in Kerala, especially, younger generation, they always look to go for foreign education, and it's very good, because they get opportunity to go and see the outside world. But your example is that you have studied in India, and I'm sure that with this kind of education, getting a job elsewhere, wherever you want, it's really possible. But you stayed here, and I'm sure that you will be able to talk about the kind of opportunity we have as a college, and the opportunity we have to build a long-term career in India. So if you could take us through that, that would be a great help for the younger generation.
Sure. So. See, I must say there are advantages and disadvantages of both of global education, Indian education. It has its own pros and cons. So I'm not arguing in either favor of one or against the other. But I'm just telling my experience that for me, reaching IIM Calcutta was a big deal. The kind of crowd that I saw there, I never imagined that I would have that sort of company with me ever. People were so talented, so dynamic, so multifaceted, so aware about what they want to do in their lives, all of that, right? So, indeed, I was so, I had such good times and I was so overwhelmed with IIM Calcutta that when I had a chance to go out for my, in a fifth term, in those days, we had a chance to go for a global, spending 3 or 4 months, one trimester in a global setup. And I never even thought about taking that chance because I just wanted to be there, just in IIM Calcutta, just living with those guys. So for me, it was a magnificent experience to be in IIM Calcutta. However, when I look back and if I see, when I see people who have done global education as well as when I see people who have studied from India, I think the biggest advantage of global education is that you get multicultural exposure. You really get great exposure in terms of the kind of students you live with, the kind of job profiles that you get. You get to start, if I'm assuming if you are studying in the top 30-40 global college, you will probably get a global role or a regional role right from beginning of your career, and that can take you very, very long in terms of where you can reach at the end of your career. However, today India is such a fast growing destination, and the kind of opportunities that India is showing, India has its own advantages. Like if you just look at Indian stock market, the market cap has grown by probably multifolds in the last 15, 20 years that I've worked. And the kind of opportunities that I've got, I probably would not have got the same if I were working in a country that was not growing as fast as India has been, right? So being in a fast growing country has its own advantages, which probably a global setup can't give you.
Okay.
The other good part about India today is because India has become such an important market for global companies, even if you are having your career in India, once you have done an India head role or something like that, the natural move after that is moving to an Asia head or a regional head or doing some global role and all. And you can see examples, right? So many people of multinational companies in the absolute top and the boards of multinational companies today are filled with Indian with Indian diaspora. So to that extent, that it's just a matter of whether you want to start at the national level first and go global, or you want to start global and it has its own advantages, disadvantages. But for me, things have worked out very well. So.
And normally when everyone get into a job and they start earning money, and that is a time a lot of people sometimes they manage it well, but sometimes they may not manage it well. So what is your take on, maybe you can quote your own personal example, maybe first time when a person get a salary paycheck, how they should start thinking about money, saving, investing, and how they should go about it?
Yeah, so one good part of Indian culture is savings is sort of a inbuilt trait in Indian culture, right? It is part of our ethos. So to that extent, when I started my journey, I was fairly sure that I had to save a certain percentage of my salary or income right from the very early days of my career. And I think that gives you a lot of... that in the long run, that gives you a lot of benefits because when you start early, even if those are small amounts, the kind of compounding that India has seen, if you have invested long, if you are in the market long enough, and really, if you had started from my point of view, if even the asset class would not have mattered. It's just that you have entered the asset class and been there for 20 years, 22 years, that would have been good enough to build a decent corpus of savings for, because India was sort of cheap. It was it was not very well recognized at that point of time. There were so many opportunities. Everything has grown so fast in India, whether it's real estate, whether it's equity markets. From a 20-year point of view, you would have made decent returns in almost every asset class. So the most important thing in investment journey, I think, is having this habit of savings right from an early stage of your career. And once you develop that, I think over a period of time, as you mature, as your income increases, you figure out what are the investment opportunities that suits you. What risk appetite do you have? And based on that, I think most people figure out a way to invest which suits themselves and their long-term goals. But the key is starting early and having a disciplined approach to it. Yeah.
And normally in our case, Kerala case, we have by default, there will be a lot of people going abroad and doing the work, and there will be a good chunk of NRIs. So when we look at NRIs, when we look at anyone who's investing in this part of the world, how about seeing India as an investment destination? Because especially NRIs will get that dollar appreciation there, bringing money to India. Is it a doubt? They're definitely doing it. So how is your take on seeing India as a real investment destination for everyone?
Well, I know the answer to that is fairly obvious for all of us. But let me start with the fact that the data speaks for itself, right? If you had invested in most large markets, and I'm talking of only dollar returns here, India would have been among the top 4-5. I'm only talking of large markets here. Over 15-20 years, India has been in the top 5 in terms of the kind of returns that investors would have got. So that speaks for itself. And we all know the fundamentals of India, right? The demographics are so strong. We'll have a growing working population for at least next 25-30 years, which itself is becoming a rarity today. Most people don't realize, but the large economies that are still growing and where working population would grow are reducing by the year. India, US, Africa, and probably some other parts of the world are the only places where working population will keep growing for another 15, 20, 30 years, depending on which country you are talking about. So we have a large working population, we have a vibrant economy, we have structural institutes. We don't have geopolitical issues which are so prevalent today and which are getting more frequent. At least now we have seen what's happening in the last 2 years. And so from all those points of view, India seems to be a stable, growing destination that really no one can ignore. So to that extent, the answer to your question is fairly obvious. If you are looking at large liquid opportunities, and if you already know India, because if you are an NRI, obviously you have a lot of knowledge about your homeland and the country. So there are very few opportunities which would be potentially as good as India and Indian economy and the growth that is likely to come over the next 10, 15 years can provide. So obviously, everyone should diversify. There should be a certain part of your assets which should be maybe in other geographies and all of that. But India, I would say, potentially has to be one of the most attractive investment opportunities, at least in our lifetimes.
Okay, thank you. And in Kerala, we have this one I normally ask to whomever I speak to, especially from Mumbai and fund management side, because we do invest mainly in gold, FD, real estate. These are the major, even I think in the rest of India also, it's almost the same thing. So what is your take on that, how good is that, and how improvement is needed in that kind of an investment?
So I guess partially we talked about this, but see, each asset class has its own risk reward, volatility, all of that characteristics, right? It's different for the fundamental drivers are different. Real estate has its own drivers. Gold is probably an international commodity and rupee depreciation. These are the two things which drive gold, and equity markets are more a reflection of your economic growth and business growth and corporate profit growth and all of that. So each of these are different in nature. But what I would like to say is, one, everyone should sort of have some idea of what their risk appetite is and what are their long-term goals are. And based on that, you should come to a conclusion that these should be my investment vehicles to achieve those goals. So it's different for different strata, economic class, different for each person, actually. But you have to do that analysis. And probably a good financial advisor can help you do that analysis. If one is not able to do it himself, having a good financial advisor at all points of time could be a good way to go about it. Second, and which is, I think, one peculiar thing about Indian middle class, that if you look at, traditionally, we have over-invested in real estate and physical assets and under-invested in financial assets, right? Indeed, I know in my own personal family and acquaintances, a lot of people would have real estate, which is more than their net worth. Yeah, right, okay. Because when you are buying a real estate, sometimes you take debt as well. So real estate actually can be more than your net worth at some point of time. So to that extent, I think one should diversify between real assets and physical assets and financial assets, because financial assets are liquid, easy to liquidate, easy to buy, all sort of. And they are more diversified in nature, right? Real estate generally tends to be chunky. One or two real estate will form a large part of your savings. So to that extent, that is one thing that in Indian middle class sort of. But that's changing right now, because if you look at the growth of financial assets over the last 10 years, it has been phenomenal, and especially post COVID and post demonetization, the spurt that we have seen. It looks like we are moving in the right direction, and over the next 10-15 years, maybe the proportion of savings in Indian household would be different from what it used to be 10-15 years ago. So to that extent, I think we are moving in the right direction. But in a nutshell, I would say one should be diversified, one should have a risk-based approach, one should have a goal-based approach. And it's different for each person, for each strata of society, all of that.
Thank you for teaching that. And personally, I always feel that everyone has a different money story, and sitting and listening and looking at an unbiased approach is something which is hard. I think that is much hard than choosing one mutual fund. I think one, I love to ask this to fund manager, okay? Can you just define fund, what is mutual fund in maybe 30 seconds or 15 seconds?
So a mutual fund is simply an investment vehicle that pools, money from different people and then invest it using a risk-based, expert-based approach. And then finally, based on those investments, your money, sort of grows with those investments. That's very simple layman definition of mutual fund. So if I were to give an example, say suppose you have 100 people giving 1 rupee each, that okay. becomes a pool of 100 rupees, and all of you have got one unit of okay. that mutual fund. Now, if that 100 becomes 200, and because you are all holding 1% of that that pool, if it becomes 200, your 1 rupee becomes 2 rupee over a certain period of time. So it's a pool of money which is managed, hopefully, by experts in a risk-based, return-based approach, okay. goal-based approach. Sorry, yeah.
Thank you. I think you have mentioned that there is an expert watching, and that is what your job is. Could you take us through what a fund manager's day like and what do you do?
That's a very difficult question. What is a fund manager's day like? Yeah, so basically the role of a fund manager is to figure out over the time horizon that you are investing in. And generally for equity fund managers, the time horizon is fairly medium to long, right? 3 to 5 years at least. over that period, what section of the economy or the market is going to do well, and where should you put your investment or the investments of the funds that you are managing such that it can generate superior returns to the market? That's always the goal, that you have, that you generate superior returns to the broader market. So to achieve that objective, you have a team of specialized research analysts, which is always there to help you. So it's never the fund manager, who is fund manager is the fund face of the fund, right? It is the team behind it who is responsible for the success of the fund and all the investments that are made. Like it's always a team effort. So we all try to figure out over the course of next 5-10 years, which sections of the society will do well. And based on the trends in the society, in the economy, in geopolitics, in commodities, which companies are likely to do well, which managements are the ones where you should put your bets on, which industries are likely to do well, and then based on your convictions, you divide the pool of money that you have into those investments, and then monitor those investments on a regular basis, whether your thesis is going right, not going right, whether what you thought would happen is happening or not, whether the probability of that happening is increasing or decreasing. So you invest and you monitor. If I had to say in two words, what is the role of a fund manager, is to invest and then to monitor. And you know, there are several other aspects of the job that I don't want to get into because that will get too technical, but that is broadly what is the role of a fund manager is. It's to decide which industries to invest and within those industries, which companies and which managements to bet on. And then to monitor at all points of time whether your thesis is going right or not.
Okay. And, you know, these days, a lot of, I think a lot of us have a DMAT account, and I think there are people who wait for that 18th birthday to open a DMAT account, and they start trading, and everyone tells that they are investing, but they end up trading. What is your take on investing in shares directly versus investing through mutual fund for a beginner? Beginner means he do not have absolutely forget about the kind of effort you are putting, but they don't know much of it. But they're just starting DMAT account and start trading. So what is your take on that, in terms of how to start entering to the capital market?
So you're putting me in a really difficult situation here.
It's not a bias answer, but you know that what is effort you're putting in your work. And I think if with a DMAT account, I'm doing your work.
See, if I had to give an honest answer to that, I would say investing is a fairly difficult, it sounds easy sometimes technology has made it so easy for people to invest and trade, and things are getting simpler, but investing is not a simple task. When we hire some analysts and give them a new sector, sometimes we tell our analysts that we are expecting to deliver for you to deliver tangible outcomes maybe after 3, 4, 5 years, because it takes almost that amount of time to just understand one particular sector of the economy. So you can imagine how much effort does it take to understand several aspects like many sectors, fundamentals of macroeconomy, geopolitics, commodities. It's just a mishmash of a lot of things. So to that extent, I would say for a beginner, although it's investment, if you are starting to invest early, it could give you a habit of savings, and that's a it's a great thing to have. But one should diversify. One should know what is his risk appetite and how much is the risk capital, and how much is sort of you know, structural capital that one would need for long-term goals, and maybe put a certain section of your capital with experts, with instruments like mutual funds and other financial instruments available in the market. And even if you are really interested in doing investments on your own, start with a small amount of or small percentage of your capital. That is one advice I can give you. And the other is have a lot of patience. Investing and learning investment is probably a 10-15 year journey at least, if not more. I'm still learning, and there are lots of things that surprise me almost on a every weekly, monthly basis. So I would say investment is at least a 10-15 year journey. But the good part of this journey is once you have spent the initial 15-20 years, then it becomes a lifelong sort of, you know, you keep learning, but you can do it for your entire life. So that's the great part about being in this profession and doing this thing, doing investments on your own. So that's what I would say. I would say have a balanced approach. Figure out how much risk one can take and how much risk you can take with your capital, and divide it in a prudent manner, and then go about it.
Could you just share one big lesson which you learned in your investing, career by doing yourself? What is that something which strike you and surprise you and learn something?
So more than one incident over the last 15-20 years, because I've been investing regularly, what it does is it improves your temperament to handle various shocks, crises, the upturns and the downturns and the drawdowns on your portfolio. How to handle those situations, that is what improves with every passing year, with every passing cycle. So for example, in 2008 or 9, when I saw my first crisis, I probably invested small amounts in the market. And when then it went down 40-50% or something of that sort, you know, you would be really nervous to what's happening. But then you see another crisis after 3-4 years, then you see another crisis. And then at the end of those 15-20 years, you figure out that actually crisis is your best opportunity. Because the amount that you invested in your first crisis, even if that was small, the returns that it has delivered has been so phenomenal that you figure out that, you know, every crisis will pass by. Finally, if you believe in the fundamentals of what you are investing in the fundamentals of your country, you know, all of these things are temporary. And in the longer run, just having the discipline to invest and invest more in a crisis, that is the biggest learning, that how to have those that temperament to invest more in when chips are down.
Okay, very good. And you know, could you share some incident where, you know, you pick the stock and you choose a company and everything, and you had to reverse that decision. At what stage you realize that, you know, I'm getting out of from this? Have you had anything like that? And what you don't have to specifically mention stock or anything, but you know, you can.
In our profession happens on a regular basis, right? Okay. So a lot of times you buy a stock, you develop a thesis that economy will move in a certain direction, or this section of economy will move in a certain direction, and this industry will move in a certain direction, and this company will do that certain things to grow in a certain manner. And some of the things don't go your way, or your initial prognosis itself go wrong in certain manners, and you have to reverse your decision. So that happens on a regular basis for us. I can give you several such examples. But what I have learned over the course of years, that the biggest task for an investment professional like me is to manage the correlations. Okay, if you diversify enough, then your mistakes become smaller because if correlations are not high. So it's like some of the biggest mistakes that I've made in my investment career is while my stocks were from different industries, they were all probably way too exposed to a certain section of the economy or a certain country, or say suppose they were exposed to European economy. So I had 4 or 5 stocks in my portfolio. Those were all from different industries, but they were all exposed to European economy.
Okay.
And in one such downturn, my portfolio was severely impacted because all 5 or 6 of those investments went down because the when European economy went through a crisis, it didn't matter which industry you were in. Mostly all of your investments went through a drawdown and a down. So what you learn is to manage the correlations, to diversify, to reduce the risk while generating the same sort of return that you want to do, generate in your investment. So that is a learning that comes across several years.
Okay.
But otherwise, to your question, have I changed my thesis? Has my thesis gone wrong? That happens every quarterly basis or 6 monthly basis in a lot of things. Like, so that is not unusual for us. That happens with everyone, actually.
Okay. I think that will kind of make you more convinced, and I think the juice will become more tasty, right? Okay. For example, a person is newly coming into investing, and if that person want to taste it, or maybe that person may be starting with a very small amount of money, maybe it could be 5,000 rupees, 10,000 rupees, something like that. So in that case, what kind of mutual fund he should enter into? Definitely, we are considering that for the next 10 years, he shouldn't take out that money. Younger person. So that what kind of fund we need to kind of select for him? If you could throw some light on that.
Today, for the beginner, the amount of financial instruments available in Indian market are so many that this is not such a big challenge, to be honest. So if you are starting your investment journey, and if probably you can diversify into either multi-asset funds, which automatically invest money in 2 or 3 different asset classes so that you have your portfolio diversified. Or you can invest in asset allocation funds, which invest in both equity, debt, and sometimes in a third asset class as well. So you would have certain proportion of your money in all the asset classes, and that gets rebalanced on a frequent basis by experts. So you have those sort of instruments available. You have the ETFs available, where if you don't want to take additional risk, you can just invest in a Nifty 50 basket or the Nifty 200 basket, where you just get returns which are commensurate with the returns of Indian economy or Indian market. So to start with, to build confidence in asset classes, it might be a good way to take this slightly lower risk approach. And as and when you get confidence and your income level increases and you get more sophisticated in your behavior, then you can start investing in slightly higher risk categories and all of that. So today, for a beginner, I think there are enough instruments available in Indian market which can give you exposure to asset classes as well as growth in Indian economy and probably some of the large foreign economies as well. One should diversify. One should have a disciplined approach. One should have a balanced approach. That's what I keep saying for beginners. To gain confidence in your investment journey, that's the best way to, or probably one of the better ways to go about it.
Okay. And talking about the fund which the fund which you are managing. And the focused fund and banking fund. So especially focused fund, it's a small fund but it's like a powerful fund. So number of stocks are less. So could you take us through that, the nature of that particular fund and who will be an ideal customer for that particular fund?
So focused fund is nothing but a concentrated flexicap fund. So if you look at focus fund and a flexicap fund, the only difference between these two funds is that focus has this restriction on number of investments that you can make. Here you have to be concentrated to a certain limit. In a flexicap fund, that limit is not there. But otherwise, focus has all the advantages and disadvantages of flexicap fund. You can move across market caps. You can move from large cap, mid cap, small cap, based on where you think value lies. So there are no restrictions on a certain being in a certain percentage of large cap or certain percentage of mid cap, or all those restrictions are not there. So it, in that way, it's a fairly flexi cap. It's a very flexible category to be in. Second, I think this is a fund where, because your number of investments are lesser than most other categories, one has to be highly convinced about most of the investments that you are making. Somewhere the best ideas of your research team and your investment team should come out in this category, because being the number of restrictions on the number of investments that you can make, some of the best ideas tend to be present in this category. So that is what focused as a category is. Who should be an ideal customer for this category? I think customers who are convinced that flexi cap is the way to go, and they want to diversify between large cap, small cap, mid cap. So customers who are good for flexi cap category are good for focus category. So there's no difference between flexi cap and focus, except for the number of investments.
It's more focused and restriction of 30.
Correct.
Yeah. Okay. So for just for example, I want to choose flexi cap, and then I have a focus fund also. So which one will be the ideal choice I should make?
So as I said, there's no difference between these two categories. It's similar. What you have to look at then, the pedigree of the institution that you are choosing, the pedigree of the fund manager, his experience, how many cycles has he gone through, because sometimes the pedigree of institution and experience of the fund manager matters as much as the category that one is investing in, right? So to that extent, I think, but between flexicap and focus, I think broadly it's similar. There is no big difference in the two categories.
Okay. And you are managing banking and financials also. So especially this sectoral funds, there are a lot of suggestion that it is a little more higher risk than other funds, right? So who will be the ideal customer to choose sectoral specific? You are banking also, and there are other sectors also. So who will be the ideal people?
For sectoral funds, of course, volatility would be at most points of time slightly higher than diversified funds. Because as I explained to you earlier, that when correlations are high, volatility is high. And sectoral funds tend to be correlated in nature, right? So ideal customer for the sectoral funds, one who is convinced that he has to take advantage of some downturn or some cyclical upturn in one particular sector. That is one. And then each sector has its own fundamental drivers. So I can talk about banking, that banking is actually a reflection of macroeconomy. If macroeconomy does well, banking sector tends to do well in most of such economies. And India, because we are so optimistic about the future of Indian economy, banking is probably one of the sort of large liquid way to take exposure to pure domestic growth. Because fundamentally, banking is more attuned to Indian macroeconomy. Global linkages are there, but they are fewer in nature. You have linkages of flows and FII outflows and inflows and some commodities, and some of your clients, banking clients, are always global in nature. But generally, banking is reflection of Indian macroeconomy. And we have seen across the world that when economy moves from this 1 to 2,000 per capita to 10 to 20,000 per capita, financial sector tend to do well in this phase, because financial sector gets more sophisticated, new industries keep emerging. So, for example, when I started my financial journey as a financial analyst, the only options or the kind of research I used to do on companies were private banks, PSU banks, and maybe a few NBFCs. Today, that basket has moved from that to private banks, PSU banks, NBFCs, microfinance, insurance companies, general insurance, asset management, wealth management, fintech companies. So the basket has become more diversified. And that's what happens when financial sector grows. So that's what I would say. Financial sector funds are good for, are suitable for customers who want to take advantage of the growth in the Indian macroeconomy. And they are a good, large, liquid way of taking exposure to Indian economy.
Okay. So if you look at the current situation, what will be the, what are the sectors we should be watching? Because there are a lot of questions from people that the renewable energy is good, or you know, everyone reads something or other and keep talking. But from your perspective, what are the sectors we should be watching from here onwards?
The sector that we are optimistic about and where we see, you know, fundamental growth drivers for the next 3 or 5 years at least, I think the most promising sector to me looks like manufacturing. It looks like India's moment of manufacturing has truly arrived, and the share of manufacturing in GDP as well as India's share of manufacturing exports and world trade will keep inching up, according to us, over the next 8-10 years. And so, and manufacturing is not one sector, it's a combination of a lot of sectors like automobiles, electronics, you have ancillaries like logistics, lots of things come under manufacturing. So I can't give you one particular sector, but I think manufacturing has been underrepresented in Indian economy for the long period of time, and that situation looks like it's correcting now. So that is one sector that we are optimistic about. Otherwise, generally, we are quite optimistic about domestic-oriented sectors, which is sectors which are more dependent on Indian economy rather than global economy. So sectors like capital goods, banking, auto, these are the sectors that we have been more optimistic over the last 3-4 years. And we are hoping global sectors will see a correction in this global anticipated slowdown that everyone is anticipating over the next year. And some of the global sectors you will find cheaper at that point of time, and you can increase your investments in them as and when opportunities arise. But as of today, we are more optimistic about domestic economy versus global economy. And so therefore, we prefer domestic sectors over global sectors.
Okay. And then it's good. I think this will be a good insight for our people listening to you. And in your fund management life and everything, what are the things which you do to ensure that you lead a happy life or a stress-free life as a person?
So, one advantage, as I said, of this job is so dynamic in nature that the job itself gives you enough thrills and excitement and sort of keeps you motivated at all points of time. So that is one. But for me personally, I am a very active person. I have glued on to sports right from my childhood. So I play a lot of tennis, football, cricket, a lot of outdoor sports. I watch a lot of sports. And so playing and watching sports is what keeps me sane. And the other is obviously spending time with your friends and family, which keeps you sane. To me, living a happy life is doing things that you want to do with the people that you want to do. Basically, that's what is crux of living a happy life.
Yeah, good. Thank you. And what is your final advice for people, from in Kerala, and the people who are listening to our talk? What would be that?
So my advice, as in, I'm only talking in investment and saving terms right now. My advice would be to have a disciplined approach towards savings and investment. And I know everyone keeps harping on this, but this is a universal truth that the time spent in markets and all in asset classes is more important than where did you put your money in and how frequently did you rebalance your portfolio and all of that. As long as you can keep a disciplined approach and keep yourself invested over a long period of time, that is the most fundamental and basic thing, and everything else comes on top of it. So my advice would be have a disciplined approach and have a long-term approach.
Thank you, thank you. I think it's a great, you know, I personally gained a lot, and it's a you know, very nice time. You know, we could share this, spend time with you, especially we got to know that how fund management world works. And I think in everyone's, you know, these days in audience, mutual funds are here and everything. Everyone knows what is mutual fund, and everyone know one thing. There is one expert sitting and watching this. So it will be great, you know, when they listen to this, they will get more insight how this person called expert and fund manager thinks and, you know, view their investment. So it's thank you so much for taking time out for us.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me here.